Doctor Who and the Power of Kroll by Terrance Dix, read by Geoffrey Beevers. Prologue. Deep beneath the waters of the immense lagoon, Kroll slept. He lay dormant, as he had lain for hundreds of years, buried in the thick, nutritious sediment that covered the bottom of the lake. His feeding tentacles radiated out from the great bulbous body, absorbing nourishment like the spreading roots of some enormous tree. The years passed by, and still Kroll slept. His body cells mutated, transformed by the strange power source he carried deep within him. Kroll grew to colossal, unimaginable size. Yet still he slept. Above him, the people of the lakes paddled silently through the marshes in their canoes and worshipped the image of Kroll in their temples, though none still living had seen him. One day, great changes came to Kroll's lagoon. Men came in rocket ships and unloaded strange machines. They built a structure of towering steel on the very edge of Kroll's lagoon. Its waters were disturbed by the sound of their machinery, a thudding vibration that penetrated even the depths where Kroll had slept so long. Kroll woke and found that he was hungry. Prompted by some long-dormant instinct, Kroll began his long, slow rise. There was life on the surface, and to Kroll, all life was food. Chapter 1. The Swamp. It was a world of water. Lagoons the size of seas covered most of its surface, so that the swampy, low-lying land masses were in constant danger of flooding. Water streamed from perpetually overcast grey skies in rain showers which ranged from the mildest drizzles to torrential downpours. Even when it wasn't raining, water seemed to hang in the air in an ever-present haze. It was no place for men. But men lived there all the same. The shuttlecraft touched down on the refinery's tiny landing pad, discharged its solitary passenger and his bulging travel bag, and took off as if it couldn't wait to get away again. Thorn stood looking for a moment at the refinery. It was built on a steel-legged platform high above the waters of the lagoon. There were gleaming metallic domes and towers, a maze of intake pipes that coiled down from the processing plant and disappeared beneath the lagoon, prefabricated plasti-steel cabins forming the control area and living quarters. Thorn stood for a moment, drawing in deep breaths of the local air. It hadn't changed. Warm, moisture-laden, the perpetual hint of rotting vegetation. He smiled. It was good to be back. He was a tall, heavily built man with broad shoulders, long arms, and enormous hands. His big-jawed, heavily moustached face gave him a rather menacing look. He stood for a moment longer looking at the refinery, his refinery. Then he picked up his travel bag, walked over to the little dock where a number of canoe-like craft were moored. Thorn tossed his bag in the nearest and paddled out to the refinery platform. Inside the refinery itself there were bright lights, metal walls, air conditioning, the perpetual throb of machinery. Thorn made his way to central control, A semicircular metal-walled chamber lined with instrument banks, dominated by the central console with its radar and viewing screens. His crew were waiting for him. They hadn't changed either. Fenner, dark, round-faced, with a look of irritable gloom, as though he had some perpetual grudge against life. Dugin, young and eager, yet with an air of nervous tension. Harg, amiable enough, but often quiet and withdrawn. Thorn himself tended to be silent and uncommunicative, so they weren't exactly a happy band of brothers, but they were all expert at their jobs and they worked well together, an efficient team. Like Thorn, they wore the blue and white uniforms of the Government Scientific Service. As usual, Dugin sat hunched over his radar screen. Fenner was checking instrument readings, and he looked up as Thorn came in.
Hello, Controller. Saw you land. How did things go on Delta Magna?
Very well. Thorn smiled briefly, as if at some private thought.
Very well indeed.
It was a useful trip. Place is getting very crowded, though. You noticed that after a few months here. Delta Magna was their home world, a bustling, heavily industrialized planet. Reasonably Earth-like, it had been one of the first to be colonized. Now, like Earth itself, it was overdeveloped to the point where its teeming population was running out of both space and food. Hence this refinery. Thorn fished inside his travel bag and handed a small parcel to Harg.
Here you are, your micro-cassettes. I got you the whole library, all 500 books.
Well, that's marvellous. How much do I owe you?
Don't worry, we'll work it out later.
Fenner touched a button, and a humanoid shuffled into the room. He wore a simple uniform of coarse grey material, and his skin was green. His name was Mensch, and he was a swampy, one of the planetoid's native inhabitants. None of the four men in the room spared him a glance. Mensch was carrying a tray of plastic cups. Fenner nodded towards it.
Care for a drink?
Thanks. Thorn took one of the cups, drained the fiery local brandy in a gulp, shuddered, and tossed the cup back on the tray.
Out,
he barked. The swampy scuttled away and stood watching in the doorway.
Hey, said Dugin suddenly. What's going on here?
Fenner looked round.
What's the matter? Do you want a drink too?
Dugin shook his head impatiently.
There's something odd on my radar. A sort of echo track.
Check it again, said Fenner indifferently.
I've checked. I've checked it 5 times. Look.
The others drifted over to the radar screen.
Here, look at this. I'll play it back for you.
Dugin touched a control, and a spot of light moved slowly across the screen.
That's you coming in, Controller, about 12 miles out. Now look, this is where the other track starts to show.
Suddenly a smaller spot of light separated from the first, streaked off on a different course, and disappeared off the edge of the screen.
What do you think it is?
I think you were followed here, sir. Someone used your radar track as cover and split off at the last minute.
Well, it's another ship, all right, said Fenner slowly. Must have landed in the swamp somewhere.
Dugin looked up at Thorn.
The scanners were set to monitor your ship's approach to the pad, sir. Any secondary plot was irrelevant.
But who'd risk it? Asked Harg. Nothing out there but swamp and wasteland anyway.
Thorn said abruptly,
Now listen to me, all of you. This could be serious. When I was on Delta Magna, I got a warning from government intelligence. The Sons of Earth are planning to arm the swampies.
Fenner groaned.
There are times I could well do without the Sons of Earth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.